My name is Chloe Rutterveld. I'm a food designer from the Netherlands, and I focus mostly on the food of the future. I combine science, technology, and design to think about new ways of food production and consumption, mostly to think about ways to make food more efficient, sustainable, or healthy. But most importantly, I try to think about food in a different way, think outside the box, inspire scientists, chefs, people working in different ways with food. I will give a couple of examples of my work, of my ideas about the future of food. But I've also been asked to talk about the process, the creative process of being a designer working with food, but also from a technological point of view. So I'm not restricted by selling products or by quantities or by what is possible at this point already. So I have more freedom to think outside of these boundaries. So I've been asked to talk a little bit about that and what that means in, like, yeah, in my working area. And to share a bit of the creative process. So how do you get from an idea or like a seed from the end product? So it will be a bit of a variation in work, in ideas, and in process. So basically, I don't know if you have seen the lecture of Kurt van Mensvoort on, I think, Wednesday or Thursday. Is there anybody who saw it? Oh, so quite some people. So actually, the Cultured Meat Project, the Meat the Future Project, was the start of how I got to be like a food designer, combining science, technology, and design. Because I was studying at the Technical University of Eindhoven, and I hated it. I really didn't enjoy what I was doing there, because when I had to pick an education or a study, it was very difficult for me, because I really didn't know what to do. Already in school, I was very fascinated by nature and the human body. I was very passionate about food because I'm from the south of the Netherlands, where food and sitting around the table sharing meals is a very important part of our culture. So my mom always would make these super large tables with a bunch of food, and we would sit around, and basically every day it would be like an eating festivity. So it's something that from my childhood was very important. But when I had to find an education, I really didn't know what to do. So I just picked something that would be fairly free, fairly creative, but also like a little bit of technology and science. So I ended up studying industrial design, which meant that I was teaching guys how to use a sewing machine, or how to, I don't know, work with fabrics. And I was like, why am I doing this? Why did I study 6 years of math and physics and I don't know what kind of things to be teaching guys how to use a sewing machine? But then everything changed when I started in the Cultured Meat team, or in the Next Nature Network team in the university. I finally, when I was working on the Cultured Meat project, could combine all of these interests of mine in one field. So the question that the students received was, can you think about a way to implement cultured meat in society? So imagine we can grow meat from the stem cells of an animal. So very short explanation, very simple, is that you take the stem cells out of a cow or any other animal, you place them in a culture that has a lot of nutrition and that allows the cells to expand or to grow. And eventually, when they start growing, you will place them as number 4 on a scaffold or something that they can attach itself to and expand with, for example, electricity. Like we move our muscles, we go to the gym, then our muscles will grow. So these cells also need some muscle movement, some physical activity in order to grow. And then eventually, when the cells have grown into clusters, they will harvest them and they will put them, for example, through a mince, like a meat mincer, and then they will form a patty, like a hamburger. So this is a very, very super short explanation of cultured meat. But for me, this was weird because how could the university ask me to think about ways to implement this meat in society if we didn't really know how exactly this would work, what you would need, how it would taste, how some more background information. So a lot of the students were thinking, oh, perhaps we can put it in a tube and then squeeze it out, or perhaps we can, I don't know, knit it, or perhaps we can. So they were thinking about all kinds of crazy things. But I wanted to know more about how it was made. And also, when I learned more about the sculptured meat, I noticed it's still made from animal cells. You still need this bovine calf serum, this culture that is also made from animals, where animals are suffering. So I thought, why, if we want to continue eating meat, like, how far are we willing to go? So is it okay to still use animals, even though it's less animals and you are hurting them less than if you just eat the animal? So what if we would use our own body, for example, to harvest the cells or to grow the sculptured meat on our own body? So that was something as a very young student at a technical university that I wanted to explore. And that was very weird. People were looking at me like I was crazy. But for me, this was very, I don't know, like a logical idea, because we are so used, if we want something, that the industry will solve it for us. So I was thinking, like, how far are we willing to go to continue eating meat? So I thought of this project, this sort of speculative design project, in vitro me, in which I designed a bioreactor amulet that could be connected to our vascular system, in which you would exchange the CO2 as a waste substance, the oxygen to feed the cells, but also the nutrients would come from our own body. So basically, it would be a direct feedback loop, and you are what you eat, and you eat what you are. So if you are very athletic or sporty and move around a lot and take care of your body, you would be growing steak, for example. And if you are super lazy, laying on the couch and not taking care of your own body, you would be making minced meat, for example. So it's like this feedback loop. If you are unhealthy and don't take care of yourself or the environment, or you would be making shitty meat or lesser quality meat. And if you would take action and be responsible and active, you would be growing a better quality of meat. Of course, this was quite speculative. So in the second project, I thought I want to make it. And I say the second project because the only thing, the only theme in the university that allowed me to continue working in this part of food design and combining science, technology, and design was this Next Nature project about cultured meat. So again, I thought, okay, whatever, I will do cultured meat project. But this time, I made it more DIY. I wanted to do it myself. So I went to the Waag, it's in Amsterdam, it's an open wet lab where they work with biotechnologies and the arts. And I just went to them and I asked, is it possible that we are going to create this cultured meat ourselves? I want to do everything, I want to follow the protocol. And basically afterwards, I want other people to have this opportunity as well, so that they understand if we have to make a choice in the future whether or not we're going to eat this new meat that is not grown in on the body of animals, or that is the animal, but that is grown in the lab. So I started by exploring the past, because how can you explore the future if you don't even know the past? Because why don't we eat the entire animal? Why did we stop eating chops and, like, we only eat the chops and steaks, but we stopped eating like the legs or the ears or the paws or all these weird things that are actually quite tasty? It takes more time and more effort and experience to prepare them well. So I did a whole lot of research and cooking with the other parts. So I just went to a butcher in Amsterdam, in the area where there were the most foreigners, to ask for like the whole head, to ask for the genitals, to ask for all these weird kind of things that normal people in the Netherlands don't eat, which was already quite difficult because many of it is prohibited or shipped to China right away because it's a delicacy there, for example, the ears or the tails of pigs. But anyway, I started making all of these dishes to get to know, like, why did we stop doing this? Is it because of wealth? So we got more money, we got the opportunity to eat better meat. Or I think it's also because we're quite lazy, because this takes a lot of effort. So in the event I created afterwards, we started with the same. We started with the first part of doing everything ourselves. So in a couple of groups, we were making these pig trotters, so the leg of a pig, filled with all the weird parts, like the grind ears, the tails, and then they have to they had to get rid of the skin first, get rid of the hairs by burning them, then fill it up, stitch it back together, and then put it in a cloth and boil it. But we were also making brains. We were making the genitals of chicken and the cum. We were making blood sausage, and basically a lot of these things which were afterwards eaten by them. And I will in a bit show a movie, and then you see that people, when sort of spending a lot of time making it, preparing it, they were willing to try it and to sort of get rid of their boundaries and their taboos. The second part was the other animal. So in that part, we were trying muskrat, water rabbit is another name for it, but also mice meat. And the reason for that is that when the scientists were first making cultured meat, they were using the stem cells of cow. But stem cells of a cow, they tend to differentiate, so to specialize into brain cells. But if you want meat, it's muscle cell. So they knew that, for example, mice cells, the same as human cells, they tend to differentiate directly into muscle cell. So why? In 2013, when cultured meat had no flavor, no taste, no texture, no nothing, everything would be added afterwards. It's just basic, like, protein tissue. So who cares if it's made from mice? Who cares if it's made from a turtle or a dinosaur, if that would be possible? Like, who cares? It's tasteless, it's structureless, it's just protein. But many people care because we are not used to eating mice. We are not the same as that we are not really used to eating insects. So I thought if we move a step further from eating these weird parts and then accepting it, moving a part further to eating these weird animals is the second step. And then eventually we would move to the DIY cultured meat making. So making this meat ourselves. And then they were so open-minded and sort of experience with all this kind of weird meat, that they were really accepting the idea of cultured meat, and especially also when they knew how it was made. So I have a movie that shows this day, which was a very, very long and interesting and experimental day, after which I stopped eating meat myself. So it has been a couple of years that I don't eat meat anymore because of this. It was very eye-opening. So I'll show it to you.
Welcome to The Other Dinner, a day in which we will explore, discuss, and taste the past, present, and future of our meat.
Ik vraag wel wat lekkere smaak eigenlijk. Ik denk dat onze maatschappij steeds verder af komt te staan van het eten. Het is tijd dat mensen zich realiseren wat ze eten.
I expect to test how much I really like meat to the limit. I think eating lots of strange parts of animals is going to make me really think about what I'm eating in a way that perhaps I haven't done before.
Het ruikt al alsof je het gebakken hebt, zeg maar.
Ik vind het heel gaaf. Ik vind het heel spannend en stoer. best gek, binnen tot buiten, muis.
It's super tiny, there's hardly any meat or hardly anything. I'm curious how it tastes.
This is a typical Limburg's black sausage.
Een paar uur ermee aan de slag te zijn. Dan is het inderdaad bijna normaal. Het idee dat als je een beest slacht, dat je hem dan helemaal opeet, ja. Dat vind ik wel een mooi idee. Van kop tot staart.
Die onderop, met juice natuurlijk.
Het is een soort kunst. In Noord-Afrika zijn er koeienkoppen, en, maar goed, geen varkenskoppen. De beestenkoppen worden daar tentoongesteld bij de slagerij. Ja.
Vlees helemaal gaat vervangen. Het is een kwestie van en. Ik kan me zo voorstellen dat iemand op maandag bonen eet en op dinsdag iets van de vegetarische slager en op woensdag kweekvlees. Ja. En dan pas op zondag eindigt het aan een stukje vlees van een dier.
Keuken van het ongewenste dier zegt, niet zomaar vernietigen, geen zinloze destructie, eten zullen we. En deze keer staat op het menu muskusrat.
Meer mensen zouden dit moeten organiseren en meer zichtbaar maken van wat je eet en waarom je het eet.
Yeah, so what this guy said sort of halfway was the longer you were working with it, or if you have been spending 2 hours working with these strange parts, these strange animals, it almost becomes normal. And I think that is something that made it very interesting to have a really good discussion afterwards about the future of meat, the future, and like if they would be willing, for example, to eat cultured meat from my cells. Would you, like, can I see some hands? Who would be willing, if you know, like, what is happening, how it's made? Would you eat cultured meat from my cells? Yeah, like, quite a lot of people. I think that's a good start. And I think, like, people should be more able to try these technologies, try these new foods themselves, or like the protocol, or that we have places where you could go to experiment. And I think, to make sort of a sidestep, that in the future, supermarkets, they should be a place to experiment, to share knowledge, to be educated with these new technologies, these new sciences. So for example, the regular groceries we would do online, and then you can imagine that these places of a supermarket where you would normally go to buy your groceries would be more of a social hub where you would come together, educate each other, but also perhaps become even part of an experiment that researchers or scientists or psychologists are working on related to food. So I think that will also be happening in the future. In the end, I was still a student, and I was already working with scientists, with chefs, with people in different fields working with food. And then I wanted to continue that, but in a technical university studying industrial design, this is not a very easy thing to do, because you were supposed to program LEDs, you're supposed to write apps, or I don't know, I don't even know how to do that. So I continued working with food, basically by just saying, I want to do this, and who is backing me up? And again, the only project I could be doing in school that was actually sort of legal for me to work with food was this cultured meat. But I was like, no, I'm done with cultured meat, I want to do something else. So I went to TNO, which is a very big research company in the Netherlands, and they were located on campus. And they were very enthusiastic about the very small portfolio I had built up through these sort of 2 years. And then they asked me, do you want to work on 3D food printing? we want you to create an a new product for like our food printer. But what they see as a new product is not a shape of a chocolate, not a shape of a sugar sculpture. And I said, no, I don't want to do that, because I think that is a bit like a waste of time. It's like a cool gadget in which you put chocolate in on one side and chocolate comes out on the other side. Why do that? It takes energy, it takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of effort, and the chocolate can be tasting better afterwards. So why would we do that? Also, yeah, I don't want to design a 3D shape because I don't even know like how to do that. So I told them, I do want to take on this project, but then I want to make more like of a challenge to find a way to print something healthy or to shorten the food production chain. So to really do something with this technology that will make a difference. So this was the status quo. It was 2014, so a lot of chocolates, a lot of sugar. And I thought, why? Why is this the only thing that we can make with 3D printing technology? Like if it's FDM, if it's squeezed out, like it just build up, or if it's powder bed printed with lasers or water, why are we only making these unhealthy candy, if you will? The problem is, or the limitation is that the thing, like the paste or the structure that goes in these syringes, they either should be solid enough so that they are firm, that you can print one layer and then one layer on top if they sort of got more firm, or they need to be powdered down. So you can use a laser or like water to melt one layer on top of the other. So like the products that you can use are fairly limited. Or you are destroying the entire nutritional value of your product because you need to like dry it, like freeze dry it, grind it, and then make sure that you can print it. So I thought, how can we turn this limitation into opportunity or into the starting point of something new? So I thought, what is small enough to go through this nozzle and then has the ability to continue growing? And then, of course, how everything starts with like seeds and other organisms like seeds, spores, yeast. They are super small and they have the ability to grow afterwards if they have the right breeding ground. So I thought, what if we can print an edible ecosystem? So I thought about a system, I called it Edible Growth, which would be built up of a breeding ground like agar-agar, for example, which is where we also grow bacteria or other or fungi to experiment with them, implemented with these organisms, so seeds, spores, and then a structure would hold it together. So this is what I sort of thought about. So we would print it, and then in 1 to 5 days, it would grow until it is fully nutritious, edible. So this is a transformation through time. So basically, the consumer would either print it themselves or buy it in a shop and shop, put it on the windowsill, and they could see the transformation. So from empty sort of empty cup to a fully grown edible. So they would also see how it would work in nature, like the photosynthesis process, the fermentation process. So also the flavor would become more intense. So like a cheese or a wine, it would age over time. So then you can pick the right moment where you think the taste is best, that you can harvest the product and eat it. So this could be something how it would look like. And I think we are here with a crowd that knows like quite a lot perhaps about science or about like nature. This won't work. This will grow moldy. So it's not possible, especially not in 2014 when 3D printing methods were very limited and not so much as possible. But it was never for me about the end product. What I wanted to achieve is to show all these companies working with 3D printing, like food theories or food machines, that they had to look for something that would either be healthy or would also be able to produce like natural food with actual textures and structures and nutrients inside of them. So that was the whole idea why I did this project. It was more like a critical node or a critical project to implement some change. But the funny thing is that everybody thought it was real. So if you would Google printed food or 3D printed food or in any order you like, you would always see my project showing up. So that's very funny because I actually never touched a 3D food printer myself. I just made it by hand, and the sculpture is made with 3D printing, but with nylon, like with powder bed, because it couldn't be done with FDM or with food at that point. So that really shows the impact of strong images and speculative design, that you can make a very big impact if it like it looks very appealing, which wasn't even my intention, but it was very funny. Like this image, it traveled all across the globe still today. So it's like 5 years ago that I did this project, and this image, like I see it even nowadays. Every week, like people ask me, journalists ask me if I can send this picture or if they can use it. Even if they don't know what it is about, they just like the image and they think, oh, 3D printing is super cool. And then I'm like, okay, whatever. But it's, yeah, this image is made in the backyard of my student house where I was living there. And I just grabbed one of my roommates and I asked if I could make a picture of her biting in this prototype. And you can see it also with her nails. And it's just, it's a very quick picture. So it's, I think it's very fascinating what happens if you just make it and try it and dare to like dream about it. In 2015, I gave a TED talk about it in Calgary, where I could share the real story, so how it happened and really like how the process would work in theory. And it was actually the start of my international career as food designer. And afterwards, I started also my own studio as food designer. But I think what is important and what I sort of learned in university to do is, if you would like draw a line, and on one side you have the existing, like the safe and the conservative, on the other side the envisioned and like the crazy, I think in the middle there is this point of innovation. So you can think about science fiction and then people will be like, oh, you are really crazy and this is never going to happen. But on the other side, it's the boring. It's what big companies often do. It's like making very tiny safe steps towards the next stadium or like the next product, which will never lead you towards an innovation because it's too safe. It's already out there. It's best possible way. It's an improvement of what you already have. So I think by daring to dream and to look at the total opposite side and then go back to sort of the realistic middle side, I think this is also the reason why companies are more and more working with designers and more connecting these different areas to sort of have people that dream and people that are very realistic and they have to make a turnover and care about the money and the implementations. So what I did when I graduated was not just open my studio, but also I wanted to know more about food itself. So I went to study raw vegan, like a plant-based school in New England. Not because I wanted to change my diet to become a raw vegan, but because it's totally something different than what we are used to. So what are you going to eat if you can't cook anything, if you can't use a microwave, if you can't basically heat anything? It's a very different way of looking at food because you don't just want to eat a salad or a smoothie or, I don't know, Soylent. So this was actually very interesting because you learn more about the natural characteristics of food. You appreciate the flavors better. You learn more about nutrition and about so what's inside and how you can sort of use other processing methods like fermentation to create really nice flavors and really nice dishes, or to tenderize something instead of that you can put it in the oven. So when I came back, I was just cooking. This is a sweet potato. And then I saw this sort of caramel stream running out of it, like this sort of sugary stream which never occurred to me before, that it's a bit weird that we see this as a healthy vegetable, as something as like, yeah, as healthy. But then if you know that so much sweetness is coming out of it, how does that make like the changes or perception about food, about vegetables? Because on the one side you have the healthy and what we see as natural, so that might be the product. And on the other side, you have the unhealthy and unnatural. So where would you place something like, I don't know, something that you could make from it? For example, if you have a sugar beet, when does it start to change from like healthy and natural to unhealthy and unnatural if you are starting to process it? And I think for every person, it will be different. Some people might think of the sugar beet as already unnatural because we need a technology to even create these sugar beets like they are today. But for some people, they're like, no, I think sugar crystals are still very natural. It's still nature, or like, I don't know. And then for other people, it changes when it is turned into a cotton candy or into a sweet, that they are like, no, this is really like a candy, or this is really unnatural or unhealthy. So I thought this was very interesting, and I thought to experiment with if I could make or like turn the sweet potato into cotton candy. And who here thinks that it is possible to turn sweet potato into cotton candy? Well, it isn't, and that is because it's a different way of, like, different kind of sugar. So in sweet potatoes, you have glucose, and you need sucrose in order, like the crystals, in order to make the cotton candy. So I went to this biotechnologist, and I asked them, okay, so I do want to turn a vegetable into cotton candy. What should I do? Which like other vegetables could I use? So they pointed me towards using like other root vegetables, like carrots, beetroots, basically everything with that contains a lot of starch. So I was experimenting with carrots, and I didn't succeed, probably because I'm very impatient, but also I don't have the right tools in my studio because it's just simple cooking material. But I ended up with a very nice, delicious syrup because I couldn't crystallize it, but I could reduce down the juice, and I made a very nice syrup out of it. And then in the end, I was left with a bunch of fiber. But my goal was to turn a vegetable into something that we would perceive as unhealthy. So I thought, what am I going to make out of this? And I'm from the Netherlands. I don't know if you know the stroopwafels, like the syrup waffles, but they're pretty famous. So for me, like, it was very clear I was going to make vegetable syrup waffles. So with these vegetables, I turned, like, I juiced them. Well, actually, at first, I was just chopping them up, adding water, and then straining them and boiling them. And then I was like, this is very impractical. I can better juice them because otherwise I have to boil out more water. So just by learning, by doing and experimenting, the process became smarter. So I would juice them, and then from the juice I would create the syrup without adding sugar. It's just very sugary from itself. And then from the fiber, I would turn it into the dough, and then together they would form a stroopwafel. So without, like, hardly any additives, just with the dough, it needed a little bit of starch because otherwise you can't slice them open. It would just be like a sort of a thick brick. It wouldn't be fluffy. So it needed some kind of starch, and it doesn't matter what kind of starch you would add. In the end, I used buckwheat because it's gluten-free. I made them with carrots, with how do you call them, like the bulb, celery egg, and with a beetroot, and actually they would still taste like a vegetable, but also somehow like a cookie. So one portion of a vegetable actually became one cookie, and it was a very good way also to let children eat vegetables. But because it was a lot of waste, I turned to like a producer of vegetables, and then also they had a line from the like the weird and the broken like vegetables, they would juice them. But with juicing them, they also had a lot of these fibers. And the juice can be sold, but the fibers were always left over because like they didn't really at that point know what to do with them. So the company would turn the for example, the carrots into these scraped vegetables, and they were left with like the waste. So from their waste, they were making the juice, which was their first consumer product. And left over was the fiber. For example, in sambal, they put the vegetable fiber as well as a filament. So if you eat like sambal, there is often carrot fiber in there as well. But they never could get rid of all these quantities. So it would either go to the bioreactor to burn it for fuel or energy. So I could use the juice and turn it into syrup and the fiber into dough, and eventually we would have the cookie. This can be very like this soft sound because in the end they made a short documentary about it, and this is a summary.
Zij bedenkt letterlijk het eten van de
in
toekomst.
Which they filmed the process from on the land and the weird part and the scrapes until how the cookies were made.
Lekkerder dan een wortel.
She says it's more tasty than a carrot. That's what she ended with. This is just a summary. They made like a whole piece of it, which it's only translated in English, but it's online. During the Dutch Design Week, I did some sort of consumer testing, because basically, like normally, I never create products that are ready for the consumer market. So this was a first because I really was looking for some more concrete things to do, because it was sometimes quite like too futuristic or speculative. So I really needed something feasible, and people really enjoyed it. And I don't know if it was because there were like free tastings, but many people afterwards asked me like, can we buy it? Like, where can we buy it? So like as I said, also the children, and we tried. So at first, and I didn't really want to, but then because there were so many like positive responses to these vegetable syrup waffles, which were a healthier and a sustainable alternative for the normal cookies, but also a way to use these vegetable ways to make something else than soups and sauces that has been done like forever. So it was a creative way to use these waste streams. But then we spent quite a lot of time thinking about how to make it a commercial product. But it's very it's very hard because there was so much fiber in the cookie. And if you like fibers, they attract moist from the atmosphere. So within 10 minutes or 15 minutes, the cookie would become soft, would become sort of like soggy. So it would lose the crunch, the crisp, and it wasn't a nice cookie anymore. So if we were to make this into a commercial product, you would have to change the whole concept. So you can turn the vegetable into a cookie, but you were just making another cookie where you would sprinkle some fiber into the dough. So I really didn't want to do that, and people didn't understand that. They were like, yeah, but you can change it, and who cares, and you still use the waste. But the problem is, if you want to use this waste, people, like the companies, are going to charge you a lot of money to use their waste. So it would be cheaper in the end to grow the carrots myself than to be dependent on their waste streams, which is ridiculous. So I said, like, it's not my business to make commercial products. So it really, I really learned from this project, but also from Edible Growth, which also many people thought I want to buy it, is that my passion is to think about these things and sort of use it as like a seed for the for scientists or chefs or whoever wants to do something with this, but it's not my job or my interest or my passion to commercialize anything. So one of the last things I want to ask you, have you ever eaten insects? And probably if you took one of the balls, you have. But can I see some, like, or who doesn't? Perhaps that's easier. Oh, also still quite a lot. You've never eaten insects? Oh, that is why you didn't want the ball. You what? Oh, eat with a face, okay. Well, I've heard other complaints that insects are just too small or very impractical, that you have to eat a bunch of them in order to get full. So moving to another commercial product, like for me, we have been talking, if you talk about future food, it's always about insects. And for me, it's so cliche because we still don't eat insects in like large quantities. And I think it also makes sense because like they are small, they are weird, we're not used to it, but what might need to happen to make this a reality? So for the, I like designed a exhibition at Nemo Science Museum in Amsterdam, and I thought, you know, I'm done with these insect cliches. I thought, let's make it, like, I don't know, like, think about a way to make it happen. So I thought perhaps, like chicken, we need to make broiler insects. So bigger, juicier, without wings, with like, make it into delicacies. So I searched for insects that have quite a nice flavor profile. For example, cicada, they are very, like, they say they taste like a combination of potato and asparagus, or grasshopper, like walnut, or wax moth larvae, like the enoki mushroom and pine nut. So I thought the flavor profiles are so interesting. Like, why can't we make them like juicy and breed them in a way that people see them as like a delicacy that are easier to eat and that the wings don't get stuck between your teeth? So I was making prototypes of how that might look like. So it would be the insects in 2019 versus the insects in 2030. So we also named the flavor profiles. And the funny thing, and that's actually also what I was hoping, was that there were people that were against. They were like, no, you can't do this. We already do this with chicken and all the other animals, and it's not how do you say it? Ethical. It's not ethical. We shouldn't do this. And other people were like, yeah, why not? It might be delicious, but then what happens if they become too big and we get scared of them? And I was like, okay, this is not what I expected, but it was very funny. But it's just, like, imagine that you would have these broiler insects, for example, as like a sushi or like a hot dog or, I don't know, like a cicada in the shape of an avocado in your salad. And of course, this is speculative and a bit weird, but why is it weird? Because we like domesticated all the animals before. So perhaps if we think the insects are a very good source of protein, and I don't know if you was here with the panel discussion, but I forgot his name, but explained that they need far less water, far less feed, far less, like basically everything, and they have quite a good, how do you say it, that they can turn plant protein into animal protein. So it might be a good alternative, even if it's broiler insects. So I just thought, let's help the discussion a little bit, and perhaps it might be a nice future scenario. To end, I have one more question. Who would prefer eating broiler insects over the current insects? Okay, so you still like, you prefer eating the regular insects if you had to eat them, like no choice, you would just have to eat insects, the current ones or the broiler ones? Well, okay, you can think about that. But to end, I will end with the future food formula, an installation I like renewed this year to make it better. But we just talked about domestication and breeding. And as many people think that food now is natural, so everything that is from the lab we find unnatural, but that is like bullshit because all the food we eat today is very highly technological. From banana to the tomatoes to watermelon to basically everything that you can think of, it's there because of technology, or like skills and knowledge and breeding and domestication. So for example, the wild tomato, they had a lot of seeds, were very small, were very bitter. But in these 2 days I've been in Poland, I also noticed that you really like bitter. So perhaps it wouldn't be that bad for you. But thanks to evolution, we have many sizes, many shapes. They are delicious. They are very tasty. And you can choose them in any kind that you like. So probably you've also seen something of vertical farming around here, but now we can also change crops by altering their growing conditions. So with all this knowledge that we obtained over the years, we noticed exactly what a certain color of light would do to the plants, like the color of light, the intensity of light, the CO2, the pH, you can name it. Everything has a certain response to the plants. For example, if you want a very fat tomato or any other plant, you would give it a lot of red light, a lot of CO2, so that it can maintain the photosynthetic rate. It needs more water then as well, because it goes much quicker. And then you get basically this very fast expanded crop. But for example, if you want to keep them smaller, you would apply more blue light. Blue light is... If the ratio between blue light and red light is higher, the blue light will stagnate growth, will cause them to be very small, but also more nutritious, which makes sense. That's also the micronutrients. So basically every light, everything has a certain influence on the crop. So why limit ourselves to these perfectly round and red tomatoes if we can, in fact, alter the crops by just experimenting with these growing recipes? Because when I first heard that we can actually do that, like change the shape, the size, the nutritional value, the color, the smell, basically everything, I thought, wow, this is like sort of magic that's already out there. So what if we would put all the genetic information of all these species of tomatoes we have developed over the years in one seed? And then depending on the growth recipe you would apply, you can choose what kind of tomato you would like. For example, like a cherry tomato or like a big giant flesh tomato. I think that would be very interesting. Let's skip the other question. It should be like the... okay, never mind. But the future food formula. So that is an installation that I made to show consumers how this process of changing plants with a growth recipe would work. So it's based on the actual science with like a tiny layer of speculation or design. So I collaborated with Wageningen University and Utrecht University to get their crop data. So exactly like what would happen to the tomato when you would apply a certain amount of light or CO2 or pH. And then we turned it into an installation.
Dan zou je kunnen denken, je doet wat meer rood licht toevoegen. Je voegt een beetje UV-licht toe. Dus dan gaat hij een beetje morfen. En dan krijg je dus eigenlijk best wel een grote, een beetje gemuteerde tomaat, zoals deze. Je kunt het ook half door midden doen, zodat je de binnenkant kan zien.
Hoe lang duurt het nog voordat we thuis, desnoods in onze eigen kleine kast, een tomaat ontwerpen? Chloe Rutzenveld is food designer en zij denkt dat dit gewoon een kwestie van tijd is.
Dus de vraag is, van, stel je voor je hebt dit later in je huis staan en je koopt een zaadje in de winkel. De vraag is dan, wat voor tomaat zou je willen? Je kan dat dus...
So this was an... I wanted to talk over the video, but the sound was too loud. But it showed the installation of how it actually works. So you can, on a sort of a touch screen, you can change the growth recipe. So you can apply more of a certain color of light, the intensity, the water. And then you can directly see on this installation what would happen to your crop. And it's basically like a prediction of when you start experimenting with tomatoes, but it also allows you to design your own future tomato. And then I think it's interesting that in the end, you can imagine that you can start cooking with growth recipes instead of with ingredients. So if you already know before the seed will grow how you want the color, the size, the nutritional value, I think that will be very interesting and fascinating. Or will we stop cooking and eating altogether? And that is my new research project in which I will be looking at functional foods. What if we would only eat functional foods in the future? So pills, shakes from nutrients like carbohydrates, starches, proteins that are produced by microorganisms in a lab. So instead of that, we are going to breed entire animals for the protein, we would just directly create protein. Or what if we would stop growing potatoes but directly grow carbohydrates? It would save a lot of land, water, feed, CO2 emission, and name it. So it's super efficient. It's just that people don't want to just eat pills or shakes. So the interesting thing that designers can start working on is how can you make these functional foods as appealing to people as regular food? So with the social like rituals and a replacement for when you would date, like what else would you do? New tools, but also what happens to the body, the mind, the environment. So together with scientists, psychologists, people just like from the medical, like it's so big. I can't even like explain it, what an impact this would have. But I think if you talk about reducing food waste, living more sustainable, looking towards a future-proof food system, this would be the answer. It's just that people are afraid of this and think, oh my God, you are crazy. But it's very, very, it's a super smart system. It's just that we don't know what will happen. So I will, in the next 2 years, I will keep working on this. And perhaps you can see something afterwards. If you are interested in the other things and want to read more about like the process or the projects, in 2018, so last year, I made a book in which I basically explain like the whole process, the technologies, but also share recipes and experiments so that you can also do something hands-on yourself or if you want to start working in this area. So thank you for listening. And if you have any questions, you can ask them. I think that's...